that or most petroglyphs, megalithic petroglyphs, are geographic. 95% of the petroglyphs of the megalithic culture are geographic. This, I hope you see it well, yeah. This is a little bit complicated. Petroglyph, not so much. This is the front side of the Tablet of Paredes. It's found in Galicia, again, northwest Spain. And it shows this shows the front side of the tablet, and this the back side of the tablet. At the right side of the front side, you see the west coast of Iberia. And the horizontal lines are the latitudes lines, the latitude lines of 30 degrees north, 40 degrees north, and 50 degrees north. And what they discovered in the sea is remarkable. Here you see three dashes, three lines, 1, 2, 3. And at 33 degrees north, they discovered the islands of Madeira. They fixed down the discovery of the islands of Madeira, circa 4,200 BC. What you see here at the other side is just fantasy. They hoped to find the other side of the Atlantic Ocean here, but they couldn't sail to the other side. Their boats were just primitive, they couldn't do that. They hoped that they find there the other side of the Atlantic, what's of course not true. The Atlantic is much and much wider. The backside of the Tablet of Paredes shows here again the Iberic Peninsula. And, well, it's a little bit difficult to explain, but it is all about this dot. There is one dot there, and that is the discovery of Rocol. Just as an islet, a very island, is now submerged, a very small island west of Scotland at 57 degrees north. The discovery of the islands of Madeira and of Rocol happened about at about the same time, 4200 BC. Before the discovery of these islands, the megalith builders discovered the Cape Verde Islands, but I skipped that story because otherwise it's too long. This shows the same petroglyph of the front side of the tablet on a map. This is the west coast of Iberia. These are these latitude lines, which were known, 4,200 BC, 30, 40, and 50. At 28 degrees, here, the bottom of the tablet are the Canary Islands, and just north of Tenerife, they discovered the islands of Madeira, two islands, the island of Madeira and the island of Porto Santo. This is a petroglyph from south of Portugal. It is a menhir. It is 4 meters high, and it shows three circles, which represent the three island groups of the Azores. They discovered the three island groups of the Azores in the middle of the ocean, the East Azores, the Central Azores, and the West Azores. As you see, at the bottom, these circles are open, which means that the land continues. You look to the west. If you look to these petroglyphs, you look to the west, and below they are open. It means that the land continues in the east, which is correct because there is the islands of Madeira are there, and the mainland of Europe, Iberia, is there. In the west, they didn't discover land. The double line here above means that they explored the sea over half a mora, what is an Egyptian mora is 10 degrees of latitude or 600 nautical miles, and half mora is 5 degrees of latitude and 300 nautical miles, 5 times 60, 300 nautical miles. So they explored the sea, but that they could not find any land around the Azores. 3600 BC is the discovery of the Azores Islands in the middle of the Atlantic. We know these dates because the archaeologists dated the monuments which show the discovery of the Azores in the middle of the ocean. This is the siltstone from the passage graves of Gavarnie in Brittany. And we can easily explain this petroglyph. You have to look from here across the stone to the north, then you look to the over the Atlantic to the north, and then this are the islands of the Canary Islands, with behind them Madeira. These are the Cape Verde Islands, which are more westerly, and these are the just now discovered Azores in the middle of the ocean. So actually they discovered four groups of islands, 3600 BC. The Azores, the Azores Islands, you can count the distance lines between all these concentric circles, and it turns out that there are 8 spaces between them, which means that they explored the sea over a distance of 8 little moras, what is 8 degrees of latitude, or 8 times 60 is 680 nautical miles. What you see here on top is a man with a lobster, that is because the man wants to cross the Atlantic, actually at the latitude of the Tropic of Cancer. That's the holy latitude for the megalith builders. The Tropic of Cancer, if you are at the latitude of the Tropic of Cancer, you know that at midsummer day, the sun is at right angles above, and the slow northerly movement of the sun turns into a southerly movement, and I believe that people believed in the sun god. It's the sun god religion of the megalith builders. Here you see 9 triangles, which are the 9 islands of the 7 islands of the Canaries, and the 2 islands of Madeira make up together 9 islands. And at the other edge of the stone, you see 9 crosses, which represent 9 islands of the Azores, which were just discovered at this monument. This monument is dated 3500 BC, and we know that the Azores Islands were discovered just 1 century before 3600 BC. This is another petroglyph from this monument, the Gavarnie. It shows the first sailing boat ever on the Atlantic Ocean. This is a stick figure, a boat with 8 paddles and a big sail here against the setting sun in the west. And this is a long shadow, but it can also be a high rock in the Atlantic, which is one of the Azores Islands, which are high above the bottom of the ocean. This is the oldest sailing boat, 3600 BC, carved in the rock. Of course, you know this petroglyph from Newgrange. It represents the 3 island groups of the Azores. Newgrange is from 3200 BC, and the 3 island groups of the Azores were already long discovered by then, because that was the discovery was 3600 BC. These spaces between, yes, you can count 4 or 5 spaces means that the sea around the island groups of the Azores were explored over a distance of 5 moras, or 300 nautical miles. Then I show you a carving from England. This is one of the color stones in Liverpool. What does this mean, this carving? Here are the British Isles. It's not very well shown. Here is Iceland, not very shown, very well shown either. But here is Greenland, what's very well shown on the petroglyph. It is it shows that they sailed via the Faroe to Iceland and even to Greenland, to the south point of Greenland, and they explored the sea here at both sides of the south point of Greenland, but they didn't find land. We can date this petroglyph to 3200 BC because we know that at that time they were exploring Cape Frevel, the south point of Greenland. This is a spiral here with 4 turns, which shows that the sailing distance from the to the Faroe Islands was 4 moras, which is 4 degrees, or 4 times 60 is 240 nautical miles. But not also that, it shows also that the sailing distance to southeast coast of Iceland was also 240 nautical miles, which is correct. Here are 2 lines which shows the way there and the return route. Well, you see here a foot with broken toes. It is so cold in Greenland that your toes freeze from your foot. It's very cold. This foot here shows 5 toes, and this downward foot shows 6 toes, which means that the expedition was successful. There were no losses. Everybody returned home safely. Well, this dot is discovery of Jan Mayen, was what is a small island east of Greenland. It's very interesting stones, the color stones. Nobody knows, but very interesting. Liverpool. Here are some other petroglyphs with geographic meanings. This is sailing route around South England up to the Faroes, and there they discovered Iceland in the northeast. Here, this is from Lufang in Brittany. Here are 2 petroglyphs from Lokru Island. This is again Iceland, and the sailing direction to the edge here to Cape Holm, Greenland, which is 15 degrees west-northwest. This is a petroglyph also from Lokru. It shows the soundscape of Greenland at 60 degrees north and the important southwest cape at 61 degrees north, 1 degree higher. This spiral here, or it is a concentric circle actually, shows that they explored the sea there across some 5 distance lines or so, 300 nautical miles, I believe. Interesting petroglyphs dating from, the discovery of Iceland is 3400 BC and of Greenland 3300 BC. This shows a very deep petroglyph of the island of Greenland, of the coast of Greenland, from here all the way to the west coast of Greenland, a very deep petroglyph from Carrowkeel in northwest Ireland. Geographic petroglyphs, most petroglyphs from the megalithic culture are geographic. This is something different. This is a ground plan from Locru, County Meath, in Ireland. It shows these black dots are all passage graves, cairns on top of the three mounds, the three hills, I should say, the three hills of this area. These three hills symbolize the three islands groups of the Azores, which are still very westerly. They didn't know about the backside of the planet Earth. They did the west. The Azores Islands are the most westerly islands on the planet. And what they also knew was the existence of the island of Greenland, the coast of Greenland. Let's see what comes next. This is. This is the most important, probably the most important petroglyphs of Western Europe in the most western stone of Cairn C. Cairn T in Locru. It is stone C8, the back stone of the passage grave. I will not go, well, I will tell you a little about it. This looks like a sailing ship, and it is one from 3200. The whole petroglyph is from 3200 BC. It was made because of the discovery of the south point of Greenland, and because of they gave up their efforts to cross the sea west of Greenland, to cross what we call now Davis Strait, I think. Yeah. What does it mean, this petroglyph? This is here in the east. It's a map of the Atlantic. The whole stone, the surface of the stone, is a map of the Atlantic. This ship that symbolizes the Strait of Gibraltar, where it starts. This. The Canary Islands, the Cape Verde Islands, these two dots here are the two islands of Madeira. These three are the three islands of the Azores. This is England and Ireland. This here, well, this is the Faroe. That's a little bit strange, but it is. And this is Iceland. This is Greenland. And this man, little man, shows that they gave up their efforts to cross the ocean at the south point of Greenland. It is 3200 BC, and it for 700 years, between 3200 BC and 2500 BC, the ocean will not be crossed. They gave up their efforts. It was too difficult. Losses were too high, and people decided to explore the planet Earth to the east. Not to the west anymore, across the Atlantic, but to the east. For that reason, there are so many monuments and petroglyphs of 3200 BC. One of the monuments, what is well known, is Stonehenge 1, the oldest monument, also of 3200 BC. This is a ground plan, official ground plan, of Stonehenge. Here are the four station stones, which have angles from the center of 23 degrees north, 23 degrees. You know that the 23 degrees corresponds, I said it earlier, with the holy tropic of Cancer. It's a holy line in the sun religion. Every monument, megalithic monument, the number 23 exists. It's a holy number for the megalithic culture. It's like the Christian cross for the Christians. It's the same. It has the same meaning, actually. We draw a few lines here. This line here, Well, it's difficult to explain. Let me see. There were originally in Stonehenge 1, there were here many years here. But let me first say something else. The ground plan, what does it mean? The ground plan of Stonehenge, what does it mean? According to me, of course, I speak on behalf of myself. It is a wall with an outside ditch. That means a round wall with an outside ditch. It is a earth circle, and the wall symbolizes the land, and the ditch the sea. So it symbolizes their thoughts that all the land was surrounded by sea. What is true? The old world here is all surrounded by sea. But here is a gap, the avenue here, what means that there is a way out. You can pass the land, you can pass the sea and explore new land, which is correct, because they discovered Iceland and Greenland. It is totally correct. If you put here the menhirs in the holes, which the menhirs are partly gone, only the heel stone survived, then you see very remarkable things. For instance, if you draw here a line, just a horizontal line to this point S1, the outer circle, then this line makes an angle of 51 degrees north. It's the latitude of Stonehenge itself. And the next menhir, if you do the same with the next menhir and you draw a line, then you get an angle of 59 degrees north, which are the Orkney Islands. It shows the start of their discoveries in the north. However, if you walk from here to this station stone, because if you look across this is the sun, so-called sun mount, and this is the moon mount. If you look across the sun mount, you look exactly in the direction of the rising sun on Midsummer Day. It's a holy line. We say it's in honor of the Egyptian god Horus. And if you look from this stone line, this station stone here across the moon mount, then you see the rise of the, what is it? The most southern rise of the full moon, in honor of the god Osiris. It's this monument dates from the start of the Egyptian civilization, and this the sun and the moon have the same meanings as the gods in Egypt. Actually, from the center to the avenue, to the hill stone, is the direction of the rise of the midsummer sun too. It is in honor of the Egyptian god Ra, what is the sun god Ra, which is the highest god in the Egyptian culture. If we go to another slide, then you will see that Stonehenge 1 gives the whole, all these discoveries in the north, the discovery of Iceland and Greenland. Because from here, if you draw lines to all the menhirs, then you see these angles, 23 degrees, is the holy, corresponds with the latitude of the holy tropic of Cancer. The 51 degrees north is Stonehenge itself. 59 degrees is the Orkney Islands, 62 degrees is the Faroe, 64 degrees is the southeast coast of Iceland, 66 degrees is the northwest point of Iceland, and 67 degrees is Cape Horn, Greenland, at the Holy Arctic Circle. The Arctic Circle is also a holy line for the megalith builders because it's the northernmost line where the sun still shines at midwinter day. So they discovered Greenland at the Holy Arctic Circle. If you walk from here to this point, the most westerly point on the Aubrey Circle, that is the circle of holes, then you will see that they also discovered the south point. Show you this here. If you walk from here, from this station stone to the most western point here, then this mania gives an angle of, 39 degrees north, what is the western Azores. But more important, the heel stone makes an angle of 60 degrees, what corresponds with the south point of Greenland, Cape Frevel, where they gave up their efforts to cross the Atlantic Ocean. So the monument of Stonehenge I, of the old part of Stonehenge, shows the discoveries in the north, 3200 BC. I will show you now some petroglyphs which are after the discovery of America, because they discovered America via the Pacific, via the Aleutian Islands, so not across the Atlantic. But after that discovery, they crossed, of course, the Atlantic. And here we have such a petroglyph from North Portugal. This is just the coast of Africa. This is the coast of Brazil at the other side. And this is the known route crossing from Africa. This is mid-ocean. And they crossed from the Cape Verde Islands, West Africa, to Cape São Roque, the Holy Rock in Brazil. These wave lines, if you count them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, then they show it's only 10 moras, the new route from here to here, and only 10 moras to South America. So this is from 2500 BC, North Portugal, near the border of Galicia, Spain. But they didn't cross America to America there, but also in the north. This shows, this is from a passage grave in Brittany, and it shows the crossing here from Iceland via South Greenland, and then from South Greenland along the west coast to the other side, to Baffin Island in Cape Chitley, Canada, at 60 degrees north. This whole carving shows the whole crossing across the Atlantic via the upper north. Here is the return route from Newfoundland all the way to Ireland back. England is here. It is the crossing by the upper north. Later petroglyphs. This is all late petroglyphs. Here is a petroglyph from Chão Redondo in North Portugal. Of course, the Iberian Peninsula here with Corsica and Sardinia, and then via Ireland, and here's a little dash which point to Iceland, and via South Greenland, West Greenland, and a crossing very high at 67 degrees north at the Holy Arctic Circle behind Greenland, because between South Greenland and Labrador is a very foggy, very difficult sailing area. They were not able to cross to America via that route. They preferred to sail up north and then here along the coast of America. And what you see here are all the latitude lines in America. 50 degrees north, 40 degrees north, 30 degrees north, 20, and 10 degrees north. The base of the stone is the equator. 2400 BC or so. This is a carved menhir at the north coast of Spain. It shows the nine islands of the Azores after the discovery of America. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, the nine islands of the Azores. You see half circles, and the open ends point to the west and to the east, which means that the land continues to the east, but also to the west. It's after discovery of America. This shows the Egyptian ships which were used to cross the Atlantic Ocean. This ship is from circa 2500 BC, and this ship is from Hatshepsut from 1500 BC. These ships were capable of crossing the Atlantic. This is a petroglyph from Brittany, from what is it? Brittany, I don't know. It shows a map of the Atlantic Ocean. This is the equator, 10 degrees, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, and 90 degrees north. And the distance lines in that time period, longitudes didn't exist. They only knew latitudes and distance lines, which are equal to latitudes. They have this. They work only with latitudes, not with longitudes. Longitudes is discovered. What we call longitudes are discovered far later. Are used far later. It shows the distance to the coast of North America. Here's a dot at the Rio de la Plata. Here are islands in the Caribbean. This is the Tropic of Cancer, the Holy Tropic of Cancer of 23 degrees north. Well, this all shows a whole map of the Atlantic. This is also a map of the North Atlantic Ocean from Brittany. Well, also distance lines to the other side. Here, this is the south point of Greenland at 60 degrees north. So this latitude is 50, 40, 30, 20 degrees north. And these are distance lines to the other side, to the east coast of North America. All these petroglyphs are after the discovery of America, circa 2400, 2300 BC. And finally, I think that's the last petroglyph which I here have. This is a map of the whole Atlantic Ocean. Here is Northwest Africa, Iberia, the coast. Here is Iceland, Greenland. And here the other side, South America. This U here is probably, it's not very clear, but it is probably Newfoundland. All the lines are here, the spaces between lines are in this special petroglyph are 3 degrees of latitude. So if you count them, then and you start here with zero, the equator, then this turns out to be 33 degrees north, which is the latitude of Madeira, and this is the latitude also of Bermuda. They sailed from Bermuda to the big dot here in the middle, which is of course the Azores in the middle of the Atlantic, and then they sailed to Madeira back home. Interesting petroglyphs. There are, this is just one petroglyph of the Atlantic Ocean, but there are far more. Okay, that's it. Thank you very much.
I've had the honor of working with Dr. Renault for the past 15 years. He's actually a physical chemist and science person. Quite a brilliant individual, as I think you'll see after a while. He chose to introduce this subject that we've been working on rather simply by introducing petroglyphs. It It's more complicated than that. I can't do much during a short time. I'll try to do a little more. My name is Jay Wakefield. A thousand years ago, you might have called me Jay of Wakefield, because that's a town a little ways from here where I originated, I believe.
Being an American, I'm also got Scotch and Higgins and some other stuff. So, I actually am from Kirkland, Washington, which is a suburb of Seattle. And so this is an unusual trip for us, but Reynaud and I have been climbing Dartmoor for 2 or 3 weeks, looking at Rose through Ireland. Last year we were down in Andalusia, so we've looked at the major megalithic sites all across Europe. We've also done America and Mexico and so on. So, we have done 2 books. The first book was Reynaud's in Dutch, and then he and I have done one together called How the Sun God Reaches America. The new book will be out in a couple more years with another 12 sites or so, including the Karnak Rose that we're working up, just finishing up now. So we've done, in over 12 years, we've done, analyzed in detail about 24 megalithic sites. It takes about 6 months per site. So it's what you're seeing now is the result of truly an enormous amount of work. We are both, I run some apartment buildings and so on, so I'm partly employed, and Reynaud teaches part-time, but really we're full-time employed doing megalithic research from the scientific end of it. And I'll explain that. In my baggage, I brought over some of these books. There's one at a university here in England. The other one, only one of the ones in England, are downstairs. Usually they cost $9 to ship over here by global mail, so you can pick them up for, American dollar isn't worth much anymore, so you can pick them up pretty cheap downstairs. I recommend it, because getting them by mail is expensive. It'll cost you just as much to mail them as to buy it. The other thing you should look into is a magazine called Ancient American, which you can Google, or just ancientamerican.com. We've printed, besides our books, we've put 20 magazine articles out. And this is the issue before the current issue, which has our explanation of the Lagatjar megalithic site near the U-boat base south of Brest. And I'll try to discuss that a little bit in a moment. But this is the leading counterculture magazine in America. It's a glossy thing. Again, although it maybe costs $32 or so, it's half price for you folks, because American dollars down the tubes. And you'll find that the pre-Columbian, this is the, we know that archaeologists are reading this under the bed covers. This is the premier magazine for pre-American, pre-Columbian culture in the United States, and I highly recommend that you take a look at this, and you can do it at ancientamerican.com. Now, we've had to learn a lot of history in order to write this subject. We're both science people. So we've done a lot of work in history to try to relate what we're finding scientifically with the history of both sides. And I want to give not only thanks to the organizers of the meeting for inviting us here to give you an introduction of the work that we've been doing for so long, but also I need to give thanks to the people who we built upon, because our work is built upon primarily Elizabeth Towig's thesis. She's a professor in Cork, and her megalithic book, which sometimes you have to pay $600 to get, is a wonderful book of petroglyphs, and we built on Aubrey Burrell. We're just building on the backs of other people, and other people will build on ours after we pass, which won't be too much longer, I'm afraid. Thor Heyerdahl. Now, there's a whole literature that you're not aware of, because it's not in the bookstores here, which kind of amazes me yesterday. And we also build on the books of Barry Fell. These are American books, and those of you trying to work in the megalithic field need to get a hold of some of these books. Barry Fell's books, three books, He was a Harvard biologist, but got into this field. One of his books is called Celtic America, and it's really turned around the thinking in America, and you've got to read that book. Other book we built on is Arlington Mallory's, which is Iron Age in America. Temple and Dreyer's book, which is an unavailable classic, but has just been reprinted on the copper mining in America. And the maybe Fred Ridholm has written a new book, The Copper, The Untold Story. It's something you need to learn about, I think. And also have built on Dr. Stichini, who at Harvard, who figured out the measures, such as the Egyptian moira, which was the measure of 1 degree. And we use the same thing as the nautical mile, which is 60 nautical miles in 1 degree. All right. So those are the units that we're trying to use. Now, this is the topic of a long talk that I've given several times in the U.S. Okay, I want you to, I find I need to explain 23 degrees. This is a photo from Mixter, who is the primary, he's the author of the best celestial navigation book in the world that I know of. It's the one I used that was taught in my class. And it shows that the Earth's axis is tilted as it goes around the sun. And that is the reason why we have seasons. And the declination is 23.27 degrees, okay? It's the position of the sun over the Earth is the greatest factor affecting the character and mode of existence of the human race. It determines the heat of the tropics, the cold and long of the Arctic nights, the calendar, the seasons, the day and night throughout the world. It's the most important element of nautical astronomy. The reason for showing you this is to remind you of this. This was known, we know this was known by the megalithic builders. It's not that preposterous because we know they knew the zodiac and it's a 26,000-year-old cycle. So this is the 23 degrees we find we have found in almost every megalithic monument we've studied, either in the number of stones or in the angles between stones. It's always in it, in large monuments. The large ones are easier to study. Now, the other thing that we use in scientifically studying these monuments that Reynaud came up with is latitude. And it may surprise you that we believe these, because latitude is technically not supposed to be known until a later date. However, we find it in megalithic monuments, and this is how it is measured. You sight your eye along the horizon and to the sun at noon, and this stick moves in and out and gives you the height of the star, okay? In other words, and they know that as you go further north, the altitude of the sun drops at noon, and it's a fairly elementary thing. This is the kind of instrument. This is in the Lisbon Maritime Museum. And as you're further north, the sun is lower, and so you use a smaller stick on the sliding scale. All right? That's how they measure latitudes. Now, this is Locru. Here's Reynaud and I. We first met when we were locked out of a museum in France, where they have very long lunches. And this was the first article we worked on together. This is Cairn T. That's my wife, Susie. This is a C8. The carvings are usually on the inside of the end stone facing the west. This is, as Reynaud showed you, this is a color photograph of the same thing Reynaud showed you. This is how they're numbered. We count the latitudes in between things, or you count the petals. Counting petals, I love you not, is very old. Okay? Here's what happens when you count these. This is the story. Sailing boat comes out, sails all this way. In fact, the correct latitudes of each island group is correct. If you add the spaces, this is designed by people that can't record what's in the air. They can't record their phonetic language, but they're smart. It's only a few thousand years ago in prehistory, and they know numbers, and they have recorded those numbers down, and we read their stories in the stones. And all the islands in the eastern Atlantic are identified here in the correct order of discovery, in the correct latitude, in the correct order of discovery, all the way around to 60, where the sun god, the westernmost known home of the sun god was in the southern Greenland for about 800 years because they couldn't cross the David Strait. There's also, they thought the sun god was in the west here because Tirna Og, everything's always in the west. So the god's always in the west. Or that's where you meet your relatives and your friends and so on, or whatever is over there. Our conception is that the megalithic people are trying to understand what's on the other side of the world and trying to find it, and that's their objective. And that in the 4,000 or 5,000 years of their existence, they managed to accomplish that. And you can see there the remains of that all around the world. This is, and again, this is the story of Lokru that they, because all you can do this in our book downstairs on your own time, and add up the numbers, and they're all correct. And then there's this little zigzag, which is the correct number of distance lines, 1, 2, 3, 4. It's the right number of latitude. It's the right number of degrees of latitude between Iceland and Greenland, because those are wave. That's how many wave latitudes there are across to Greenland. And here's where the Vikings lived in the megalithic. When the Viking people got there, they found stone buildings, and those were megalithic buildings left over also in the Western Cape. There's a roof stone overhead. When you're in Lokru, look overhead, right over that western stone. And if you use the same methodology I just explained to you, you get this story. That they went to Iceland, they explained all these latitudes off Iceland, couldn't find any water out, any land out in this ocean. But they did explore down the Greenland coast. The roof stone explains all the way down here. This is the roof stone using the same methodology, which verifies the technique, I think, partly. You use the same methodology on one petroglyph and the other, and you get a sensible story, extending the story to explain what happens. This caterpillar-looking like thing means they explored the coast. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 degrees of latitude long, which is correct, and about 1, 2, 3 degrees of latitude out. Stonehenge Reno covered. It's a remarkable monument because there's 1,000 years between the beginning, between the first phase and the second phase. Reno explained that there's a perfect 90 degree corner between two astronomic events, between the moon mound and the sun mound. There's a perfect 90 degree corner. Only at the 51 degree latitude of Stonehenge is that true. So that's why this monument is at 51 degrees north. And all the islands have the correct degrees that are equal to their latitudes. You can take this, you can go home and do this yourself. There's absolutely no question that these islands are accurately identified by Stonehenge 1. Because you can do it yourself. In our book, we explain Stonehenge 3. It's a much more complicated and maybe more ambiguous. But this is absolutely clear to you, and you can do it yourself. There they are again. I'm going to show you a place you may not be familiar with. This is America's Stonehenge. It used to be known as Mystery Hill. It's in North Salem, New Hampshire. The date is the same as Stonehenge 3. It was constructed at the same time. The date is established by radiocarbon dating. We don't change any dates in our work. We just accept ones that are established for these sites. What you see here is housing that's encroaching on this site. It's owned oddly by Mr. Stone. Okay. So there's a site in the middle that American archaeology doesn't know what to do with. Now, but the University of Pennsylvania has verified all these alignments. This is a reader board there, and you can see all these. We're not specialists in this astronomy stuff. It's clear that the site has all this. The University of Pennsylvania has verified all this. And there's an outlier. Here's the two guys. All right. This is a sacrifice stone here, they so-called. It's got the place for the blood to come off me. The only thing, it's supposition, but here, in our book, we describe this as a place where navigators were trained to cross the Atlantic and get back home. And they probably had to sacrifice something to do that. There's this oracle chamber down underneath where you can lie and your voice comes up under the stones. And it's
It's quite the place. There are a lot of chambers here. You'll recognize that this is, there's Mr. Stone owns the place. Recognize that this is a megalithic site, not unlike ones you're more familiar with yourself. Complicated studies have been done at the sea level, and they know at the time a mystery hill was used that the sea level was much higher than now. Here's existing, and the depth then was here, so that the sea coast is not here. The big ice sheets have melted, so now the land has risen. Now the seacoast's out there. But it used to be here so that a little boat could come into this harbor right around this site. So we have a megalithic site on the seacoast. Brano and I did 6 months of study on this. I don't think I have it in me to do it again. But this is where all the chambers are in the main site. These stones are the outliers. From this single point, you can identify all the map, all the places around the Atlantic Ocean in their correct latitudes. For example, this main alignment here, stone M, is at 39 degrees. That's the West Azores. This is Mystery Hill. Just, you can read in our book if you're interested, and you should. It's much more complicated in our book, but we spent 6 months doing it. But this is kind of the summary. What this shows is that it's not only an astronomic site, but it's a geographic site. It's a map. It's a walk-in map of the ocean. And I'm not going to explain it to you, but in the Orkneys, those three huge rings are the same thing. They're a walk-in map of the ocean with Greenland in it. But Mystery Hill has got one particular interesting thing. This is the map they give tourists that walk through the site, because the bustlers show up every day. And here, Reno put, the alignments are correct, and Reno wrote all the little things on it here, which is a part of our work. But here's an angle that said Cape Home, and there's Iceland. He says, you know, I've done this work, and I think I understand this site, but maybe not, because there should be a rock here. Cape Home was real important. He says, I think I know how the megalithic thing people were thinking. He says, I can think like they wouldn't build a thing and not have a rock there. So I don't think he's going to throw away this whole site and all the work he did for 6 months because there's no rock there. There is no rock. These other ones are rocks. M, K, P, L, J, R. Those are all rocks. There's no rock. So he comes over for vacation. We get in the car. We drive up here. We go walking around the site. Well, there's a man here laying down. It was 14 feet long. And we asked the owner, well, how come at that point there's this big rock? How come you didn't put it on the thing? He says, well, why would I do that? It's broken. So this is the what I'm showing you. Was the most remarkable thing in my 15 years of working with Reynaud. This is the scientific validation of our theory that these people use latitudes, because Reynaud predicted this stone would be here, never having seen the site. Now, if anyone can say that, I'd like to hear it. He said this men here would be there, and it was. It's the damnedest thing I ever saw. Okay. Little travelogue. We're going down to the Gulf of Morbihan. This is Google Earth. This is the Gulf of Morbihan today as it looks at current water level. In the middle of it is a monument called Gabarine that the Karnak rows are up in here. This island at Gabarine has a, this is Gulf of Morbihan with the tide going out. They got enormous, amazing boats down there. I mean, there's a lot of sailing talent in this place. They've been master sailors since for 8,000 years. They're probably winning the transatlantic right now. This island in the middle of this place, here's that stone that was described earlier, the circle of wind under it is underwater. But this is the tumulus of Gabarini. And there's Reno standing in the entrance. It's the most decorated tomb in the world. There are, would you believe it,
20, there are 23 decorated stones, and the 23rd stone is white quartz. They're floor to ceiling. They look like this. They don't let you take pictures, see, because it's just a little floor lighting and no pictures and so on and so on. So that's all I can get, but I wanted to show you what it looks like inside. These are the end stones. This, as Reno said, these are the Azores Islands, the two, the center and the eastern. Here's just a couple of, this is an absolutely beautiful monument, and you can study it in our book. The thing is oriented to true north, 38 degrees off. It's about the Azores at 38 degrees. Okay? Guess how many stones this monument's made out of? Great big stones. 38 stones. Here it is. The 23 engraved stones are darkened. The 23rd is white. The axis is at 38 degrees. There's a total of 39 stones. And the Azores are at 38, 39 degrees north. You've got to look at this stuff mathematically, because they didn't move these stones for nothing. They are encoding their stories, and we can read their stories now. And Reno has introduced just a marvelous interpretation of this, of the European sites, and it's dovetailing with what we're learning on the American sites. The French guide says, "Oh, look at this! These are hunter gatherers. Look at here's a boat." You know. But he forgets to account that there's 23 rowers sitting in the boat. These are all just explorations in the ocean. We think they were trying to cross at 23 degrees, but if you do that, because that's the holy latitude, but if you do that, you get into doldrums and you die. It's horse latitudes. That's where you eat your horses. Okay, I'm an old sailor, and I've read the Salem books. So, but if you go get blown north out of the horse latitudes, you can follow the birds. There's no commercial fishing or anything. You follow the birds and you get to you can see why they probably found the Azores, which were the westernmost land known on Earth for a long time until they found Greenland. That's why the triple thing, the three islands, is so common in megalithic art. Reno showed you this. I just wanted to show you these X's across the top because you want to look at the same thing at Newgrange and tell me that the culture isn't the same both places. Okay? This is Brest is right over here. This is the Camaray Peninsula. I want you to look at this little place. This is Google Earth. In that plate, here it is again. All of this is Nazi fortifications for the U-boats behind. It was pretty well defended. Okay, these are some of the Nazi fortifications there. There's a U-boat, they were based there. Now the atomic fleet's in the same place. This is a tear-jerking thing. This is a Breton woman breaking the Nazi chains. It's just dramatic. This is the megalithic site there. 48 stones in a row. And this is Google Earth again. This is what you see with Google Earth. 48 stones in a row. It's interesting because this is a 48 degrees north. So is the south, the western, the easternmost, closest part of North America. Where is that? South of Newfoundland. That's a 48 degrees north. And where did the copper come from in the Bronze Age? It came from Isle Royale. And where's that? 48 degrees north. We'll get to that in a minute. We have time. This is Lagajar Rose. This is the Labrador Strait. In the old days, people had to go up to the Arctic Circle. This is how the stones lay out at that site. Every stone, if you assign 1 degree of latitude to every stone, then the site makes sense. This was published in Ancient American month before last. This is the way it is on an existing map. In the old days, they had to sail the route given by the sun god, just like they did over here. It's a complementary of 23 degrees. So that's the old route. Then we find a lot of sites where 65 is a shortcut. But at Lagajar, there's this road that's disconnected at the ends. A new sailing route was found into the Gulf of St. Lawrence through Belle Isle Strait. This is a monument to the discovery of this new route. And the latitudes are all correct. These are pretty nasty pots. from the Pitcher Museum, again with all these latitude lines on it. So this is prior to 3000, prior to the pharaohs. Here's an old boat, more megalithic. You'll recognize these. This is pre-dynastic Egypt, before 3000. This is University of Pennsylvania collection. Here's that boat again. And with eight rowers and a boat, so then nine, again, for the Azores. This is the Egyptian boat going to Punt. The Punt fleet of Hatshepsut. There's 1,000 years of ship development between the early ships of Sahura and the Punt and the ships of Hatshepsut. So there's 1,000 years of boat development between one and the other. I know something about it. I built this boat, which is this a sailing. Now you don't see much of it, but it's a catch sailing in Canada. This is what the Egyptian ships somebody draws would look like. So they had big boats. This is the Ulubaran ship. There were 8 or 10 tons of copper ingots found in this boat off the coast of Turkey. That's the size of it. This is a chart of the Atlantic showing the same routes we've been discussing. The northern route up past Iceland and down, the southern route across to the Caribbean, and the grasshoppers are blowing across there when there's a big storm in the Sahara, as you know. They got disease in the Caribbean that's caused by bugs coming from the Sahara. It's a problem today. So that's a very easy route. My parents did that recently, or a while back, when my mother was still alive. And the route back was to the Azores here, or later through past Bermuda. So those are sailing routes. Okay, should I end?
We have to stop very soon. Yeah.
Well, I've got a few slides on the copper. Would you like a little on copper, or do you want to go to lunch? Or do some of you want to go and not? I can tell a copper story.
I think three more minutes to stop.
Okay, I'll proceed. This is a photo of a scuba diver under Lake Superior. This is what raw copper looks like when it's never been touched by man. This is a huge poster at the entrance of the Seaman Mineral Museum in Houghton, Michigan, which is one of the premier mineral museums in the world. This copper was sticking up like this all over the ground. They call it float copper because the Laurentian ice sheets over Canada did a big sluicing of copper that was embedded into lava layers billions of years ago. And they called it float copper. It was all over the woods and on the edges of the lakes, it would have been shiny. You can see that this is Isle Royal. You can see the lava cut edgewise. The lava goes down and under Lake Superior and up at the Keweenaw. And these are all, this is the mining island, Minong Island. This is where 500 million pounds of copper were mined by, legend says, white, yellow-haired, blue-eyed people between 2200 BC and 1200 BC. At 1200 BC, it ended. These are some of the holes. These are some of the axes used. They broke. Most of them are broken, if you can get one, because they use them until they broke. This is one of the trenches in the woods. They went down 30 feet, so there's been thousands of years of detritus falling into these. But these tunnels, these run all through the woods. There's 10,000 of these holes. America was electrified by mines that were built on top of these ancient mines. So now it's national park. You go down 9,000 feet in these mines, just like the tin mines, you go down 2,000 feet. Some of the new mines, but the old mines went down about 30 feet. They followed veins down. They found on the surface and went there. So I'm showing you where an enormous amount of copper disappeared. In America, they have no idea where it went. They find a few little arrowheads and a few little this and that that the Indians are carrying around, but they have no idea where 500 million pounds, 10,000 pits, where it went. This is a ship going up the Mississippi. This is another subject. We've got a cave where refugees escaped to America, and they drew maps of the Mississippi. This is a map of Great Lakes showing the Keweenaw Peninsula and the Isle Royal. Again, this is a much later date, about zero. This is 1,200 years after the mining. Where did the copper go? There are pits with the remains of copper
have been found all through the Great Lakes and here at Poverty Point. This is northeast Louisiana here. The Mississippi used to go down through here. Now it's a bayou, which is what's a leftover place where the Mississippi used to go. Poverty Point's right next to high ground. It was only found from the air, these huge rings, half a mile wide. This was the biggest Bronze Age city in the world, we think, because of the enormous amount of food and the bios around it. What did they do here? There's what's left. This is my last slide. This has just been done. You're seeing the current edge of archaeology in America. This is an aerial magnetometer of Poverty Point rings. And what you're seeing here, the dark dots, are metal. And there should be no metal in a Mississippi along where the Mississippi River is flowing down. But they find copper on the ground, small amounts, and look at this stuff. And this has not been dug yet to find out if that's a pit full of copper. But half a billion pounds of copper disappeared in America. It's a big subject. You can go to Michigan Copper, you can study it a lot of different ways, there's a lot of literature. And at the same time, you walk into the British Museum and there's a placard on copper, on bronze implements, and the placard says, before 2500 BC, there were copper and bronze implements in lower Mediterranean, but at 2500, they exploded all over Europe in big volume. Okay? And then you go, Ned Reynaud and I were down at Las Milleres, that site the other speaker mentioned in Andalusia, and there's a sign that says, this copper smelting site was abandoned at 2200 BC, exactly when all this copper was loaded into ships. So it's a fascinating story. It involves both sides of both continents, and I'm disappointed to find a lot of the literature, like Barry Fell's books and so on, not in your bookstores here, but I encourage you all to help us in this research and get involved. Thank you very much.
That was fascinating. That was the most fascinating thing. Thank you very, very much. And we've now got just over an hour to have lunch.